The realization that leads to liberation, leads to the vision of oneness, I'm convinced it is basically the realization we don't need to do anything. Now, how that comes upon one is, you know, is you have to keep practicing at it. This morning, the realization dawned on me, and then it, you know, it's gotten a little fuzzy during the day. But we don't have to fine tune anything for the light of lovingness to rest upon everything, for the vision of oneness, for the oneness, this overlay, to rest upon everything. We don't have to calibrate anything. We don't have to tweak anything. We don't have to say, okay, I just need to make some little adjustment. No adjustment required. No adjustment required. This is the overwhelming realization that we have to train for, to prepare for. I see these non-dual teachers, maybe they are enlightened, some of them, but they keep just saying, just, there is no I, just let it go. And the people are just like, I don't know, I can't do it. You got to train for it, you got to prepare for it. You have to practice for it. Yeah, this is my opinion, this is how I see it. You because of the continuity problem. They still don't recognize the continuity problem. It's why we struggle. So, the ego is in charge of fine-tuning everything. The ego says, great, you're going to be enlightened, wonderful. I'll help you out. I'll help you out. I'll help you fine-tune everything, tweak everything, get it all perfect. So it finally fits. It finally fits in here. What the ego is trying to do is blend truth and lies. That's what it's trying to do. He can't do that. Can't do that at all. So it's futile. We're so used to thinking that our enlightenment should drop down at any moment. We just have to, like, it's like a Rubik's Cube. We just gotta make the right combination and there it is. Finally it drops in and we get it. No, there's nothing to get. There's nothing to get. There's no changes that need to be made, therefore there's nothing to get. Nothing that needs to be known. This I that gets being people talked about, you can look at it many different ways, really. But it one way is to just say it's the ego's advice that we need to do something. So there's a doer there who presumably is going to change something. So the I is the one who is going to make the changes under the advice of the ego. I means a change to be made. Awaiting until the change has been made. It's not a person. It's not like that at all. It's not an identity or person. We're just waiting. You know, we're waiting for some change to be made so everything fits. This is the delusion. There's no change that needs to be made. Looking for an analogy. Like you're putting paint on smooth wood or let's say rough wood. You're painting rough wood, actually, real heavy paint, you know, or staining. Let's say you're staining some rough redwood, staining some wood. And someone says, whoa, you can't stain that yet. I've got to, you know, smooth this out. I've got to move this little rough area here. Just let me push this a little bit here. Let me tweak this a little bit here. And it just got this basic rough, you know, Conhard redwood for like a fence or something. And someone's saying, "Nah, don't stain it yet. Don't stain it yet. I see this texture here. Let me move it a little bit. It's not going to be right. It's just the stain isn't going to work. It's not going to work." Of course it will work. Put the stain on and it's stained. So the ego says, no, it won't work right. It won't be good enough for you yet. you there's something, you see, something isn't right, the ego says. There's something that isn't quite right. You can feel it. There's something that isn't right. What is it that's not right that keeps us waiting? And we presume this waiting is for this I to make a change, some change to be made. See, our mind cannot easily handle this. Cannot easily handle it. The answer is right there. It's the continuity problem. Nobody seems to recognize this. The reason why we're waiting for a change to be made is the continuity problem. There doesn't need to be any change. It's like you're pouring an ocean out upon the land. Let's say an entire ocean's being poured out upon the land. And somebody says, well, wait a minute. I need to tamp this area down right here. Let me tamp this, or let me scrape this a little bit. And, you know, you're pouring, it's going to be under 2 miles of ocean, you know. The ocean's going to fit just fine on top of any landscape. Water is going to take, you know, it's going to conform to whatever's there. It's going to overlay the landscape. We don't have to do anything. But because of the continuity problem, we act like we need to do something first. So what I saw this morning was, I just realized, wow, all our problems, all our sicknesses, nothing has to be altered in the slightest bit. Our cancer, our sickness, our dying, our aging, our arthritis, every sickness, every problem, or miseries, whatever situation it, none of that has to be altered in the slightest bit for this totally clear, translucent, and transparent. I don't know if I can have both of those in the same sentence. Clear, transparent, wide open, light of beauty. To bathe everything in its light. Everything is bathed in its light. Nothing has to be altered in the slightest bit. Because the only thing we're looking at is the beauty of the light. We're not looking at the cancer, the arthritis, the health, the crippledness, the agedness, the decrepitude, all the various troubles, the stresses, the mental angst. We're not looking at that. We're looking at what it's being bathed in, what's resting upon it. So it doesn't matter what it's resting upon at all. It makes no difference whatsoever. That's why nothing has to be changed. However it is right now, it's perfect. However it is right now, it is perfect. However it is right now, it is perfect. This is the central realization. And it, you know, it dawned on me this morning. I just said, wow. I said, wow. What do you mean? Right now we can, it's perfect right now. It's the perfect time for it. It is always the perfect time for it. It is always the perfect time for it. It's never not the perfect time for the vision of oneness. It's never not the perfect time. And this is what has to dawn upon us. And we have to practice acceptance of this. And this gets rid of the whole problem, the whole situation of the supposed I and all this stuff that people are just like stuck. No. Acknowledge the continuity problem. And therefore, then work on the continuity problem. And then the whole thing, you'll see it in a different light, entirely different light. We're not worried about our identity, the self, the I. We're not worried about any of that. We're worried about the continuity problem. If you don't solve that, you won't solve anything. So, practicing the continuity problem techniques and practices enables us to feel comfortable with recognizing, hey, this is the perfect moment for it. But all moments are the perfect moment for it. We see that. There's no moment that isn't perfect. Because the light already is beautiful. The light of this non-relative beauty is already has all these qualities which we've gone over practicing. It's already that. And it's not altered in the slightest bit by what it rests upon. What it rests upon has no bearing on its beauty. None. Zero. So why do we need to rearrange anything? Why do we need to arrange something? Do we say, wait a minute, these flowers aren't arranged properly. I'm not quite ready for the vision of oneness. Or, you know, the day is not right. The atmosphere is not right. I don't want it resting on this day because it might ruin it. You know, I want to have a nice day for it. It doesn't make any difference where anything is location. It is non-locational, totally non-relative, totally non-locational. Makes absolutely no difference where anything is, where anything's going, what the disposition of it, of anything is in this world or in the universe. Zero difference. Completely irrelevant. So someone could be lying in a rest home as there are millions of people dying of rotting, you know, their flesh rotting and dying, gobbling pills. And when they don't behave the way their caretakers want to behave, they double the pills and sometimes triple them. And then they don't have to worry about them misbehaving anymore. And yet, the beautiness, the light of this non-relative beauty, the vision of oneness, rests upon that person rotting in that drugged up person rotting in that bed, in that room, in the back of some assisted living place where there's 15 other beds, 15 other people all rotting away too. And it doesn't matter. None of that matters at all. The light is equally beautiful resting upon a rotting corpse as it is resting upon Mount Fuji in the morning, and at dawn or something, you know, or the Grand Canyon or anything, you know. It is equally beautiful. It has no bearing on it whatsoever. And the only important fact is this fact: it looks the same everywhere. So all these appearances of impermanence and death and sickness don't change the loveliness of light at all. That reminds us of reality. It says, hey, reality is still completely real and nothing has affected it. None of this dream affects it in the slightest bit. And it's still gloriously beautiful. And that is what we need to know. That's it. We don't need to find a cure for cancer. We need to find a cure for the continuity problem. If we put all the money and the attention and funding we put into curing cancer into resolving the continuity problem, focusing on that, there wouldn't even be any world. We would have let go of it long ago. We would have let go of this nightmare long ago. But we keep insisting that no, we need to make things better here. Everything's perfect. Perfectly ready for the vision of oneness. Everything is in perfect readiness for the vision of oneness. This is what we must convince ourselves of. Otherwise, we'll keep waiting. And then we'll worry about, well, what is this I? How come I can't get rid of this I? We'll go to satsang and try to listen to the teacher and say, gosh, how come I can't get rid of that I? You know, we're still waiting. He says, well, it's not the perfect time. It's not the perfect time for it. Not quite ready yet. So we keep looking at this central issue. We're waiting, but it's already perfect circumstances, ideal circumstances, flawless circumstances, and it'll never change. Nothing that happens changes this fact in the slightest bit here. Never will. That's why the future is totally unnecessary. It's not going to change this fact at all. No matter what happens in the future, it will always be a perfect time for the vision of oneness. It's always been a perfect time. So what use is it for us to delay and rearrange things? Which is, of course, the future is just a bunch of rearranging, right? It's always just rearranging. Demographic, everything's always shifting. Always shifting. You live in a place long enough, you see how everything is shifting and changing constantly. All totally unnecessary. It doesn't matter one way or the other. Keep doing it, that's fine. It doesn't make any difference. It doesn't make the slightest bit of difference what happens in this world. Not the slightest bit of difference. Because the overlay of this overflowing light of beauty which bathes everything in its clear, calm, still, smooth light is totally unaffected, totally untouched by what it touches. It's not transformed or dimmed or adjusted or calibrated or tuned by what it touches at all. Not at all, not in the slightest bit. So what does it matter? What it's resting upon. It doesn't matter. It's just that it's resting upon everything equally. That's the only thing that matters. That's the only thing that matters. So, of course, it makes no difference. Why are we waiting then? Futile. Just a complete waste of time. And the more we can see this and see this and see this, the closer we will get. And of course, the mind doesn't like to waste time. When the mind sees it's just this is all just a waste of time, then it'll say, hey, okay, yeah, let's do it. Let's do it. I don't want to just waste time in a completely useless way. It's ridiculous. Once the mind gets it, then it gets it. So we're just working to get to that point where we get it. When you see it starting to dawn, and then you can look at it, and then you can see, okay, this is what I need to get. And how do I, work towards that? How do I practice that? You know, they say in satsang, just let the eye drop away, just let it drop away. Yeah, the eye is the agent of change, right? Well, it's just let it, and just realize it now. Well, yeah, of course. But it's easier said than done. And you can spend your lifetime waiting. It's better to practice something that pulls up this expectation, that aligns our valuing with it. Aligning one's valuing, practicing aligning valuing is right practice. I get the impression in satsang I'm not sure why practice is not requested and actually insisted upon. I'm not really sure about that. That's a bit of a mystery. But we'll see. We'll see. In the meantime, we will practice. Do the sure way, the safe way. Don't hope for just suddenly the self revealing itself. Well, why not, make sure that this is going to happen by doing right practice. The self revealing itself is a continuity issue. It cannot reveal itself as long as we're afraid. As long as our fear, continuity fear, leads to us projecting our will, okay? This is the problem, and it needs to be brought to light. When our will is projected, we think it's split. And so we think we need to heal this split. And so we think that the light, that bathes everything in this light of beauty, we're not ready for it because our will is split. And we think it would cause irretrievable loss, where you have these two wills bathed in this beauty, and they each one will say, "Oh, I don't need to heal the split anymore. I got what I want." And so we'd be irretrievably separated. So we won't do it. So as long as our will seems split to us, we won't do it. We won't do it. I don't care, you can sit in satsang for 35 years, you won't do it. So the more we work on the continuity problem, the more we realize our will is not split. We've just been disassociating the will. Disassociating, projecting, denying, disassociating. But it's not split at all. So therefore, we can allow this light to touch and rest upon everything without exception. And it will not lead to an irrevocable split. This is what concerns us. This is why we hesitate. The I is just a conglomeration of delaying defenses. That's all it is. And we'll keep delaying as long as we think that our will is split. So we have to reduce the continuity fear. Reduce. So we can begin to recognize that, hey, the power of decision is within me. I haven't lost my will. It's here. I'm able to align it. I'm able to bring it to bear upon this. There isn't any split will. Because we think we don't want to empower a split will that's working against us. There is no will that's working, a split will working against us. We're projecting it and imagining it's working against us. But it's still our will. It hasn't left us. It has not left us. So we could do a little better than what I think the non-dual satsang. We can do a little better. And they always say, well, for some reason, it's projected will is the reason. It's the desire to be greater than the prime creator. It's this initial projection. It's the disassociation. It's the perception. It's personality. It's continuity problem. It's not just for, quote unquote, some reason. You know, like, I don't know, for some reason, No, it's not just some vague thing like that. It's very specifically delineated, not in all its bizarre Byzantine complexity as all the projections and all the defenses, but in the basic elements of it, it's very easy to delineate it. That's why we hesitate. We just hesitate. We hesitate, we turn to the conglomeration of delaying tactics that we call I, potential self, you know. You think, oh, there's a potential self in there. No, there isn't. It's just delaying tactics out of fear. Of course, all these delaying tactics are so precious for us. We think that they're saving us from a total breakdown of identity, continuity disaster. And so we make up this notion that there's some future self, that these defenses are actually giving birth to some future self. The I. So, oh, yeah, it's nurturing in the I. Now, this is just a convention we say to rationalize it and to give it importance to us. And we look at them and say, oh, no, I can't let go of that. That is the I. There's a new self being formed there. It's just made up. It's just completely made up. It's like you have this poisonous snake in your hand. And you think that if you let go of the poisonous snake, you'll disappear. Now, let's just say this for example. And you look at the poisonous snake and you say, oh my God, this is my dear, dear, lovely pet, you know, or something like that. Oh, no, this is a harmless, lovely, wonderful pet, you know, because you think, if I realized it was a poisonous snake, I'd throw it away. So we insist that this conglomeration of defensive tactics, of delaying tactics, the delaying tactics of the ego, we can say, no, those aren't delaying tactics. That's the matrix, the womb of this new self that is being born, this glorious, wonderful child. My child is being born out of that. We are simply making that up out of fear to keep some attachment to it. We want an attachment to this stuff because we're worried. We hate this situation. We want to throw all that delay down, throw it down. But we say, oh my God, if I do that, I'll be catapulted back into reality. I can't have that. Oh no, this is not delay. This is the nurturance of my new self, this wonderful new self, of myself. This is me. It's nurturing me. It's giving birth to my greatness. I must keep it. That's the quote-unquote I. There's no I there. There's never been an I there. We're just inventing this notion to maintain our attachment to it. That's all. So there's no question, where does the I go? There is no I there. Is where do the defensives, delaying tactics go? And it's just, the answer is the same thing of where does the song on the piano go when we stop playing? It just, there's no more song because no one's playing it anymore. That's all. It doesn't go anywhere. Remember, we're projecting all these defenses. These are not permanent. These are not creations. So when we stop projecting them, they don't arise anymore. That's all. There's no disappearance of I or anything. There's no I there. There's no person there. There's no self there. Never has been. But we're just imagining that, oh, there must be, for the sake of our attachments to it. That's the only reason. Sake of our attachments to it. Let's say there's this ferocious storm, lightning and thunder and rain and snow and sleet, and we got this little rundown, crumbling shack, and we are like some log, let's say some big log in the forest, and we get underneath it, and we're hiding underneath it, and we'd really like to get out of there. You know, there's bugs and snakes and weird spiders, and oh God, it's terrible. But we're so afraid if we come outside, we'll get hit by the lightning or something. So we say, oh, this place I'm in, this is like the best, coolest place I've ever been in my entire life. I mean, it's just, I got no problem with it. I love this place. In fact, I want to stay here forever. It's that cool. You know, we tell ourselves these things to avoid a worse fear. So we tell ourselves that there's some I, some self in all these defenses, this conglomeration of delaying tactics. You say, oh, that's my dearly beloved son, my dearly beloved child. This is my dearly beloved future. This is, oh, yuck, I love it. This is wonderful. This is life. This is life. And we tell ourselves this. So we hold on to it. That's it. We just tell ourselves this lie, so we'll hold on to it. We invent it in our imagination. We just say, I better really have this ideal image of these defenses, these tactics. Otherwise, I'm going to throw them down, and then I think I'm going to be catapulted back to reality. I don't know how to function there. I've completely forgotten what reality's like. How can I function there? So we just keep this lie going, this ridiculous notion that there's some person, some I, some self, in these defenses that it adds up to something. It doesn't add up to anything. But we'll never admit to that and recognize and accept it as long as we are afraid of this continuity issue, as long as we don't realize the vision of oneness is there, that we just like the air to glide. We spread our wings out and we just glide on this air. It holds us up. It holds us up. It's buoyant. It's totally buoyant. We don't have to go directly back to reality. And then we can realize, I just was saying there was an eye there because I was really scared. There's never an eye there. I just made it up. I just made up. That's all. So, It's like, let's say, you're going along a road in the jungle in India or something in ancient times, and some people jump out on the side of the road, and they're going to kill you, they say, and then someone whispers to you and says, hey, they worship the snake, and if you see a snake, the snake, they won't touch you. They'll let you go. I said, really? Wow, okay. And you see this rope in the road, and you say, oh my God, there's the snake. Look at the snake. Oh my God, look at that snake. It's a wonderful snake. And you hallucinate the snake. You see the snake. It's there. It's right there. You see these thuggies. You say, hey, oh my God. And you're bowing. You're worshiping the snake, you know. And you say, yeah, there's a snake there. And you won't accept the fact that there has never been a snake there until you get out of harm's way, as it were. And then you can say, yeah, I just was hallucinating that out of fear, so I could believe in it, so I could try to convince them. And maybe they say, I don't see a snake. Say, no, well, maybe it just, you know, it just went off the side of the road. It's right over there now. There it is, or something. You just won't let it go until you're safe. So when we're in a severely threatened position, that we think we're severely threatened, we're capable of hallucinating. We're capable of seeing what's not even there. So we're looking at this mass of defenses, delaying tactics of the ego, and we're hallucinating that there's a self there, that there's an I, that there's an identity, that there's a person there. We say, oh yeah, it even has a name. It even has a name. Yeah, it has a name. My name. Of course. What do you mean it's not there? Is it? I've got a name for it. I even call a name. It responds. It, you know. No, we're just acting as if there's an actual person there. Just acting. It's play acting. It's nothing, no person there. Never has been for anyone. But we're told this is what keeps us safe from reality, from jumping back into reality. So we cling to it like crazy. We cling to our craziness. And it's not a good thing to try to bust that up. It's not a good thing to bust that up. You got to go at it indirectly. You know, don't try to hard sell people, say, there is no I. Come on, jump. There is no I. You got to let it go. Let it go. No, they're holding on to this notion out of desperate fear. They're hallucinating. They're believing this out of total, extreme dread. So just say, okay, fine. We're not even going to worry about the I, whether it's there or not, whatever. We're just going to work on the continuity problem. At least we can agree to that fundamental principle. I have a severe continuity problem. I can't remember what reality is like. And we can admit, yeah, I'm inventing this I, but I'm going to keep inventing it until I can get confidence in resolving this continuity problem. And we say, no problem, of course, sure. Don't even worry about it. Don't even sweat it. Keep believing in your name, yourself, there's an I. No problem at all. Don't even struggle with it. Don't struggle with it. Do not struggle with this whole question of the I. You know, what is the I? Where is the I? Blah, 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 blah. Don't struggle with it. Go at it indirectly. Don't go after it. You're not going after it. You're going after the continuity problem. I don't have an I problem. I have a continuity problem. The more you focus on the continuity problem, the more everything else softens up. Softens up. Because you're not trying to attack it directly. You're not trying to attack yourself and saying that you're stupid. How come you think there's an I there? Get rid of it. You know, stop thinking that. No, it's there because of the continuity fear. So turn to the continuity fear and start practicing ways to get ready for the vision of oneness. And then all this other stuff will just gently, compassionately, you'll just smile at it and just say, ah, okay. You have compassion on yourself. Have compassion on yourself. It's not doing this because out of fun. It's doing this out of dread. It's in a dreadful spot. So we have to show maximum compassion for ourselves. For me, I don't even care if there's an I or not an I. I never, hardly ever think about it. I'm just speaking of this because I see this, the satsang and the non-dual, all this stuff, and people struggling so bad. I just say, whoa, you know, hey, go at it indirectly. Go at it through the continuity problem, which is really the direct way. Actually, the continuity problem is the direct way. But we're also focused on getting rid of this I, realizing it's not there. We don't pay any attention to the continuity problem, which is the cause of the I being projected onto this delay, massive delaying tactics in the first place. We're just projecting this notion upon it. That's all. We won't drop the projection until we realize, you know, that I can have a soft landing into the vision of oneness. And this the vision of oneness is the soft landing back to reality. There is a soft landing, a very gentle soft landing. I mean, some of these super advanced teachers, like from India, you know, these are the creme de la creme of thousands of years, and they're teaching, and the Westerners come over, and they think they get it. They think, okay, I got it. But these teachers, again, are you know, super rare, super advanced, and so the way they look at it is, yeah, just, of course there is no I. You get to that point, you see there is no I, and that's fine, that's fine. It has taken, you know, their entire culture for thousands of years, thousands and thousands of gurus and sages, etc., massive amounts of meditation practice over this time, all massive cultural acceptance and help over this time. And these are the very top ones. They eventually get it, okay? You cannot take a Westerner out of our Western society and put them over there and come in, you know, in a year or two or whatever, 3 years, so, oh, okay, I get it. Yeah. This is very unlikely. It's very highly unlikely. You know, it's feasible, it's possible, but still, we don't have that type of culture of support and acceptance, and we don't, you know, it's we have to go at it in the safe, effective way. The safe, effective way. And that is to recognize and confess I have a continuity problem. I don't have any other problem. I don't have an I problem. I have a continuity problem. And work at it and practice at it. They say, give up, you don't need any practice. Just direct realization. Just drop the I. Boom, done. You know, but what practice do you need? Just be quiet, drop the I, and it's done. Again, keep in mind that the one that's talking, those great gurus are talking, they're the top of the toppermost. Those are the ones that got it from, like, maybe some of the great avatars, okay? And they may have been just a few may have gotten it from the great avatars, and they got it, okay, because they were had done a massive amount of work in previous incarnations. So they're the top of the toppermost. We're not at the top of the toppermost. And they're part of an overall cultural push, you know. It is a lot to it, a lot to it. We have a cultural push of our own in the West. Judeo-Christianity, for instance. And so we can use that. We can use that. We also have the rational thinking, the reasoning, rational thinking, looking at it. We're very much workaholics in this tradition. You know, we're very skillful in certain ways. We use the traditions that you're in, have been in. Use those. Make them work for you. Don't throw them away and think you can go over to some completely different tradition, culture, and deal with some avatar and just and say, oh yeah, okay, sure, that's easy. Yeah, there is no I. Yeah, I get it. Yeah. But then everybody else, come on, everybody, just realize there is no I. Come on, there is no I. that's the result of a tremendous tradition. So art. The tradition in the West can work. It absolutely can work. tradition, within that tradition, I don't teach the non-dual type of satsang stuff that the way people do it. They come up and let me talk about you, and kind of argue, persuade you out of your eye. No. I teach the continuity practice. That's what I'm teaching, is the continuity practice. Continuity practice. Say, I don't have an eye problem. I don't have any eye problem. I have a continuity problem. There is a true I, there is a true self, of course. We're just projecting it on these delaying tactics. So we can use the term I, that's no problem. I don't have an I problem. I have a continuity problem. The I problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness. Only the name of God has value for me. Only the thought of God has value for me. Only the joy of God has value for me. Only the peace of God has value for me. Only the light of loveliness has value for me. Only the light of non-related beauty, of non-related, non-localized, formless, transparent, clear beauty has value for me. Only that, nothing else has value for me. And so you work at it this way, and eventually you say, hey, you know what, I don't really need to project an eye onto all these delaying tactics. It's no longer necessary. And you stop doing it. It's no big deal. You just say, it's no longer necessary. I don't feel like I need to do that. You know, my fear is gone. I don't have to do that. And it's just so you stop projecting. You stop playing the piano, it goes quiet. Piano goes quiet. And don't try to impose quietness and stillness on yourself. It's like you're playing the piano and you say, okay, I'm just not going to hear anything. I'm just going to be quiet. I'm not going to hear anything. The piano's still being played. Practice to the point where you realize you don't need to practice at all, because this overlay of this light of loveliness, a light of beauty, is overlaying everything, is touching everything, is resting upon everything without exception. Everything without exception, equally without exception. It's making no judgment whatsoever on anything. And it's not being affected in the slightest bit by anything whatsoever. So nothing has to be rearranged. Nothing has to be rearranged. This moment as it is a supremely perfect moment for this vision of oneness. It is the supremely perfect moment for it. And we just have to keep reinforcing all of this. And once we accept, yeah, I understand this, I get it, yeah, this is right. And we don't need to keep projecting an eye upon these delaying tactics, because we don't need the delaying tactics. We don't need an attachment to them. We're trying to form an attachment with these by thinking that they're our offspring, that they're in charge of our baby, our child or something. Of course then we'll be attached to it. So eventually we say, I don't even need these tactics. So no need to project any attachment upon them. And it just resolves that way. Just resolves that way. We don't have to resolve it directly at all. It's resolved indirectly, actually. All of that is resolved indirectly. So don't worry that we're not struggling with this I kind of thing. It's not necessary. It's not necessary. All this stuff just leaves on its own accord. That's why I have these dreams of all this stuff just leaving me, fleeing me. See, I can't hang out with you anymore. I'm gone. Because the fear is lessening. The projections, I don't need to project anymore. What happens when you don't project anymore? No more projection. And the last thing you see the projection is it's saying, hey, I'm leaving you, I'm gone. Well, is gone is actually not arising anymore, is what's happening. But for the sake of continuity, we kind of first think, oh yeah, it left me. But no, it's just like you stop playing the piano. Or maybe you're just playing a few notes and you stop playing with one hand and you don't hear that part anymore because you're not playing it anymore. That's why. And you're down to like just a few notes, maybe just one note, and all you're hearing is that one note. All the other notes, so where'd they go? They're not being played anymore. So they're not arising anymore. And then you realize that one note, you don't need to project on that anymore. You're comfortable realizing this is the optimal moment right now. It's always optimal. It's always optimal. It as it is always optimal. It as it is, this as it is always optimal. This is what we need to keep telling ourselves. this moment as it is. This as it is always optimal. This is always optimal. This as it is always optimal. And then we just take the hand off the piano, not even thinking about playing anymore. We're realizing it's optimal. So, and then there's no more song, no more tune, no more notes. So we don't have to try to be quiet. It just is quiet. It is quiet. The piano's quiet. So you don't want to try to reach quietness, stillness, or try to reach it, you know, through grasping it, mentally getting it. No. Don't try to get anything except this is the optimal moment. Nothing needs to be changed. Nothing needs to be rearranged. Just get that. And everything else, automatically, you'll get it. It just falls right in place, automatically. So when you go and see these great teachers, it's like they look at you and you say, oh my gosh, they seem to think this is the optimal moment for me. Now that is valid, you know. I don't, to some extent, I think the teachers are doing that, okay, to some extent, yeah. And you say, holy cow, you know. They see this as the optimal moment for me. Oh my God, this is it. Well, that's pretty scary. So I would say that going to, you know, the great teachers, you have to really be ready for that. This is just an opinion. You know, I could change the opinion, but because they truly see you, this is the they know this is the optimal moment for you. It always is. It always is. And they're seeing that, but then that can really scare you because you say, "Well, I'm not ready." What do you mean it's optimal? And then, oh, I missed my opportunity. I had the optimal moment and I didn't do it, and I missed my opportunity. So it needs to be explained. It needs to be explained. Sometimes I think that the Westerners go into the East because it's a good delaying tactic, actually. They think, no, look, I'm having satsang and Rishikesh, and the guru is great, and I'm really having a wonderful spiritual time, and I'm this is just optimal use of my time, this is great. Well, if they would just stay at home and be doing these continuity practices, they'd probably be way farther along. I remember Sri Anandamayi Ma, the Westerners would come to her, and she would usually say, look, what's your tradition? They'd say, well, it's Judeo-Christian. She goes, well, go home and practice your tradition and just practice it more intensely. That's what she'd say. Great advice, you see, great advice. Go home, practice your tradition, but do it much more. If you use me as motivation, use me to motivate you to practice more, more intensely, more devotedly, devote more time and effort to your practice. That's what she'd say. And it's right. It's very good advice. So again, I think a lot of people say, hey, I don't want to admit that I'm kind of slacking. So, but I want to slack because I'm afraid of the continuity issue and I don't seem to understand how to deal with this. So let me go over to India. Let me hang out with the guru and let me get this contact high and let me, you know, do all this stuff. And I can at least say, look, I'm not slacking. I'm sitting by the Ganga, you know, the Ganges. I'm sitting there meditating. This is great. It's incredible. Look at the backdrop. You know, look at this place. Om, om, om. But the continuity problem remains extremely potent for them, you know. They're trying to get a mental concept of liberation. They're trying to get a state of liberation. And of course the non-dual teachers, they just dropped all these states. Well, how are you going to do that when you've got a severe continuity problem? Those states are a defense mechanism. Those are delaying tactics. You can't just get someone to directly drop all the delaying tactics unless the fruit is totally ripe and they've already done all the continuity exercises, then you can have a guru just say, hey, time to, why don't just drop it now? And you say, oh yeah, okay, boom. So that can happen. But those happen to the top of the toppermost, okay? Those who've already done the preparation. So it's best to stay in your tradition and then make that tradition, within that tradition, focus on the continuity problem in whatever way you can. Different people have different practices, different traditions, etc. But I've tried to make this continuity practice span all teachings, all religions, but I would say everyone needs to adapt it in some way that they feel, you know, comfortable with. But the awareness that the continuity problem is our only problem, I think that is a very valid focus. Very valid focus. How we work on it differs. How we work on it can differ. So I'm just suggesting the way the Holy Spirit is suggesting to me, right here, right now. But I'm sure that there are, you know, lots of various ways to work on it. But you need to work on it. And the other stuff, don't work on it directly. Don't worry about it. It's all projections. It's all projections. There's nothing else, projections. And we, as long as we believe there's a split will, we'll keep believing, we'll keep being afraid of this whole projection situation. So it's a log jam. It's a log jam. Have to work on it in a way that the ego claims is indirect. It's really, working on the continuity problem is really working directly. The ego just says, oh, that's so indirect. Why don't you work on the I, getting rid of the I? And of course the non-dualists say, well, there is no I there. Well, why do we think it's there? It's a projection. It's a projection, it's a defense mechanism. We're terrified, that's why we're projecting. So, if you're not really practicing effectively, you're probably slacking and have a very good excuse to slack, I would say. I say, no, I'm with this teacher, I'm doing this, whatever. Slacking, it's slacking. But it has a patina of legitimacy, right, from the teacher. Or the teaching, or the tradition, etc. I've seen so much of that, so much of that. Stay grounded in your work ethic. Stay grounded in your work ethic. The work ethic of the Western tradition, being a part of that, I know I have this just incredible work ethic, did in previous lives too, just, you know, a doer, a worker, someone who is just driven to sweat the details, to get the job done on time. I mean, look at this Western society, how we, efficiency, doing it on time. I mean, the whole business, the business world, it's intense, it is so intense. And so we have this natural bent to get it done, and to use some format to get it done, to have some plan, to have some practice, to, you know, get it done. And so we work hard at it. We work hard at it. It's not for us to just, you know, take some other totally opposite viewpoint as if that's going to somehow, you know, blend two viewpoints, blends stuff together. Forget it. Just work hard at it. Don't just say, no, I'm just going to sit here. I'm just going to be still for the next 10 years. Forget it. Forget that. If you say, I'm gonna work really hard for the next 10 years, you know, hours and hours every day working on this continuity problem, well, in 10 years' time, you know, you will probably have made so many breakthroughs, you will know that you are going to drop your projection at some point soon. You'll know it. You'll be super advanced, actually. Super advanced. But we're told by, for various reasons, and we can speculate on those, that, oh no, we're supposed to abandon our tradition. We're supposed to be smoke pot, hang out in Goa, you know, dance to trance music. We're supposed to travel here, travel there, meet some guru, attend a satsang, all this kind of stuff, and that we're very spiritual. No, that's a scam. That's a scam. That undermines the culture. We should be getting after it. The way we got after, like, a law degree or a medical degree or whatever, some degree, we should be getting after, you know, 10 times more intensely than that. But for some reason, the ego keeps convincing us we need to get in some yoga asana, and do some breathing exercises or something. We cannot relate to that. That is super technical. A lot of that yoga is super technical, super advanced. Extremely, you need a very advanced teacher to watch you very carefully. Oh, forget about it, you know. Don't mess with that stuff. It can work. They can manage to get there. But if that is not, you know, if you're not totally in that flow of that whole thing, forget about it. Forget about it. It's a waste of time. For some reason, there was this huge push for all that stuff here in the West. And now we got a whole nation of spiritual slackers, actually. We dropped the rigors of it, thinking, hey, there's an easier way. I can relax and smoke pot, and I think there's an easier way. And we abandoned, you know, the intensity, the rigors of our own tradition that we feel comfortable in. And that will work. That will work for us. And we abandon it. And fortunately, Jesus brought it back. And of course, in miracles, he says, hey, get after it here. Get after it. Get studying. Get practicing. Get applying. Use concepts. Use words the right way. Use concepts the right way. You know, direct your valuing here. Understand the structure of it. You know, get clear about the big picture here. You know, like Mr. and Mrs. Businessman. You know, it's your business. Get after your business here. So, I mean, I live in the Silicon Valley. People here are just maniacs, you know, business maniacs. I mean, the whole time I've lived here, it's just, you know, it's people here are driven. They are self-motivated, driven people to succeed. And they're relentless. And they manage their time. They are focused. They're alert. You know, they're geared for success. There's no nonsense here. There is no nonsense here. We don't put up with any nonsense here. So it's that atmosphere, you know, is actually a good one to realize, hey, there's no nonsense here. We're after the prize here. You know, of course, they're after billions of dollars. They're after, you know, buyout, startup buyout thing. I mean, people come here and they realize if we get something going in maybe 4 years or something, we're gonna be, you know, multimillionaires. So they eat and sleep and dream their project. I mean, they're just locked in on their project like maniacs. So for me, it's easy for me to be locked in on this project, because being locked in on something is just the air that we breathe here. And that's the tradition, the Western tradition. That's what it is all about. You know, serious, serious business, serious, serious success, pursuing serious success. We're not smoking hashish in Goa, you know, and looking at the moon or something, walk along the beach. You know, no time for that. Hey, look at those Don't even want to go there. Have to be serious. You have to repent. You have to say, I have a super serious problem. If you have a super serious problem, then you're going to pursue super serious effort, right? Can't remember what reality's like. I really cannot. Just the vaguest of vagueness. I've tried, but it's still very vague and fuzzy, you know, very vague and fuzzy. So that's a terrible problem, because that means I'm going to stay with what I'm familiar with, which is this, you know, wretched garbage dump here. So that's a severe problem. So you have a severe problem, you better train, you better work at it. Everybody has the same problem. So everybody should be training, everybody should be working at it in their own way. Now maybe in the East, it's sitting in a cave quietly for 30 years, that's possible. Or hooking up with a supreme yoga master and doing the various breathing, various asanas. This is all very technical stuff, okay? And the yoga masters told the West, hey, don't mess with this stuff. You know, forget about those people who are trying to popularize it. It's dangerous. It is dangerous stuff. It is. It's dangerous stuff. Don't try to play with these energies. Don't dally with the ego. Don't. This egoic problem of projection, our fear, the continuity problem, this whole thing of the ego, what it's trying to do, you know, you don't mess with it. Don't mess with it. Get aligned with right spiritual practice and stay on that. Because this egoic stuff, you don't want to try and directly get into that stuff and try working on that stuff. The ego is not to be trifled with. These problems are not to be trifled with. Have to get on the continuity problem, which is the safe way, because that's where the Holy Spirit meets us, with the aligning us with the vision of oneness, giving us right spiritual practice that aligns our expectations with that. We don't mess with other stuff. We don't mess with other stuff. It's a jungle out there. You wander out in that jungle, look out. Look out. It is brutal. The defenses are brutal because we are terrified. So we've made some very nasty defenses to keep. We've tried to embrace and again project attachment to some extraordinarily nasty defenses. It's like we're embracing death. We're so attached to death, actually. This is true. We're very attached to death because we think it saves us from going back to reality. That's the simple fact of the matter. And you start messing with that defense, you're going to get in big trouble. So don't directly mess with these defenses. Don't try to be immortal, okay? Don't try to be ageless. Don't try to, you know, all that kind of stuff. Don't do it. Don't have anything to do with it. All of that will simply stop arising when you stop playing the piano of projection. All of that, automatically. You don't have to do anything. But when you try to put the cart before the front of the horse, you're asking for the worst kind of troubles. Now the ego make it sound glamorous and stuff, but forget it. Forget the glamour about it. Forget the glamour. Just do the simple, feeble practices that we do. The imperfect, feeble. Because it's aligned with the Holy Spirit's will. It's aligned with our will, the Holy Spirit's will. It is aligned with this vision of oneness that is there for us. The clear light that is bathing everything without exception. That reminds us of reality. It's all aligned with that. So you just keep this alignment going. And the other stuff, you know, one day you just say, oh, yeah, that's gone. It's not even a problem anymore. It's just disappeared. I don't know. Where'd it go? I don't know. I don't care. The ego will say, wow, how'd you do that? That's unbelievable. You got to tell us how you do it. I say, I don't even care how I did it. I don't want to try to teach people how to do it, because trying to do it directly is the wrong way. So it just left. I don't care how it left or why it left or whatever. I just stopped projecting it is all. Just because I was no longer afraid. So afraid of the continuity problem, it's just automatically just melted away. Gone. Stop playing the piano, that's all. But the ego wants you to, you know, oh, how did that happen? How did you do that? All this stuff. Don't worry. Whatever wants to leave, just let it leave. Don't follow it to figure out how you, you know, don't interrogate it. Say, why'd you leave me? What did I do to make you leave? Now, just leave. I don't care. I don't care. That's the secret. When these complexes start leaving you, don't try to stop them, chase them down, and say, wait a minute, what kind of practice did I do to make you leave? I want to know, because then I can tell the whole world and everybody say, oh, wow, I got some. No, that's the wrong way. Say, I don't care. I don't want to hear anything from you. Goodbye. I don't want to hear a thing from you. Just go. Because it's all a projection based on our continuity fear, all of it. All of it. And it just means our continuity fear is lessening. That's why they left. That's all. And the ape is the vision of oneness anyway, so we don't really have anything to do with what leaves us. What leaves us, that's all. It's just no longer arising, and that's just notice it and just keep going on. That's all. Don't break your stride at all for anything. Don't break your stride at all for anything. So I'm making all these practices, these continuity practices. We'll see what the Holy Spirit suggests next. I don't know. Never know. You never know. But it's always better. It's always better. It's always wonderful. It's always very helpful. And just stick with it. Stick with your work ethic. Determination, seriousness is like a career. This is your business. This is your career. This is your family. This is your life. This is what you're doing. And so do it well to the best of your ability. And of course it's going to be feeble because we're terrified. We say, oh my gosh, I might maybe this is the perfect moment, and I'm going to see I'm going to see everything bathed in this beautiful clear light, and oh my gosh, oh wait a minute, what's going to happen to the eye? That question. Just don't answer the question. Don't answer. We know that's a ruse, right? Don't even talk about the eye. What's going to happen to it or something? No. Just a projection. It's not even there. It doesn't matter. We just stop projecting is all. Okay. So, this is just a little talk here. It's a little break from the intense practice. We're just putting everything into context here. Putting everything into context. Stick with your work ethic. Don't worry about all these glamorous teachers in glamorous spiritual places and people and thinking, oh, if I were just there, I'd probably get it right this moment. No, you can get it right where you are better than if you go travel someplace. You should be able to get where you are better because you're more familiar with those surroundings and you can more easily realize, hey, this moment as it is totally perfect, optimal, problem-free moment for the light of beauty to rest upon, to see it that's resting upon everything. It is immaculately optimal. It is immaculately optimal. Right here, right now. This is where you can accept that. Okay? But if you don't accept it now, the next moment too is perfectly optimal. And on and on and on and on and on. It's always perfectly optimal. Nothing needs to change or not change. Nothing needs to be rearranged or not rearranged. Nothing has to happen or not happen. Makes absolutely no difference what the dance is. Absolutely zero difference. No factor whatsoever. Zero factor. Don't have to factor it in at all. A lot easier, isn't it? Don't have to factor it in at all. Okay. That's it for this one. And we'll see what's next. Should be great. Okay, that's it.